Bee Movie is about a young bee, Barry B. Benson.
He's just coming out of college. He knows what he likes and doesn't like, but he's asked a big question.
So you'll just work us to death?
We'll try.
By a series of circumstances, he ends up outside the hive.
Whoa.
And he gets very distracted and excited by the human world.
What happened?
I just tried to talk to these guys.
Then there was a dustbuster, a toupee, a life raft exploded. Now one's bald, one's in a boat, and they're both unconscious.
One of Barry's journeys in B-Movie is from his not quite appreciating how important bees are to the world. And during the course of the movie, Barry learns every job's important, and they all add up.
B-Movie felt like a fantastic heroic story of this tiny character going up against this huge world, and it felt like a fantastic journey and a challenge.
For making a B-movie, we used over 100 XW9300s and 9400s to complete the film, and we actually ended up using over 5,000 compute cores on the film. So that, again, is a new high watermark for us, where, again, we're always pushing the envelope in terms of what we can do creatively, and the rendering appetite keeps going up. Shrek 1, the original, was 5 million render hours. Shrek 2, 10 million render hours. Shrek the third, at 20 million render hours. And B-Movie, 23 million render hours. So we keep climbing.
We're seeing things in the B-Movie we've never seen on screen before. And because the performance of the workstation has gotten so incredibly good, the artists are getting closer and closer to the director's overall ambition for the film.
We use technology to enable our filmmakers, and having great partners like AMD and HP enable us to do that like never before.
So when Jerry came up with this idea, he was very excited about it, but said, look, I have to be honest, it's not going to be possible because my family and my life is in New York City. And I said, well, we may have a solution to that. So we showed him Halo. And I said to Jerry, we will build one of these rooms for you at your office on 57th Street in New York. And every day you can come and literally spend 5, 6, 7 hours collaborating with these artists. Frankly, if it weren't for Halo, we would have never made this movie, and it would not have been possible.
You know, a lot of communication is nonverbal, so you want to see someone's face and their posture, and so you kind of know, you know, what you're talking about and what this other person is thinking. It was fun, it was easy, and otherwise impossible.
When we look at something on my Avid, we run a sequence and talk about it, and then if we want to do any rewriting, we just punch in the laptop, put it in, see if it's working. So even just because of the technology, I've been more involved in that side of it. And that's been great.
Jerry got to be a first-hand participant in the creation of his movie from New York, which, again, was a technological marvel, to be able to sort of step into a room, connect with the people who were making the film here, and have that sort of daily interaction where he felt like his creative vision was realized in the making of the movie.
For Jerry, it was always really important that this movie have many locations. For him, as a writer, he just likes the characters to move and to go places. We ended up with 43 different locations in this movie.
It's two full worlds. It's a whole bee world and a whole human world.
Hi!
How did you learn to do the talking thing?
I don't know. Mama, Dada, honey, you pick it up.
The big trick in getting the movie to work was, is the audience going to buy this little tiny character who's only an inch tall and this human woman?
We had to figure out a way to keep it feeling natural and not make it feel like Barry's in the land of the giants.
You know, if you have very small characters and very large characters that are interacting, or if they're flying and they're going to go far away from the screen and close to the screen, you have to scale the character. You have to make them smaller or larger.
The amounts of data that we've had to push through to get the film completed has been enormous, and the technology has actually made it possible to do things we would have never been able to do before.
Well, the big discovery that Barry makes in the story is that humans eat their honey.
Cute bee. Golden Blossom. This is stealing!
The honey for Bee Movie was a particular challenge because of its sort of simulation and its visual impact. How is light interacting as it hits the surface, as it enters the surface, as it bounces around within the surface? The AMD sort of processing power really helped us get to that level. So when you see the movie, you know, it looks like honey.
There were tons of crowds of bees. I mean, you know, a crowd of bees is more than like two or three humans, right? It's like 50,000 bees all of a sudden, and they're flying through Central Park.
This is the biggest mobs we've ever dealt with in our studio. It went from thousands to tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands to millions.
Having the processing power behind, you know, the filmmakers is a key component to making these films. Right? Having enough, knowing that when you get down to the crunch at the last few weeks and few shots, that you've got all this processing power behind you, you've got the ability to get access to multiple cores, you've got the ability to address more memory. That is a key enabler to making these films.
In a lot of the shots that they were doing for the courtroom scene and in the scene at the airport, you had thousands and thousands of bees. And we tried to render out thousands of bees with bum fur, we ran into problems. Because fur is expensive. We had to look at different approaches for a level of detail for that in order to enable us to render the bee bum fur for the bees that were close, but to be able to have bald bums for bees that were far away.
There's an insatiable appetite that our artists have for creation and creating new and unusual imagery. And the more power we can put in their hands, the more spectacular the imagery comes to life on screen.
Making great films at DreamWorks really means two things: great stories and great filmmaking. And great filmmaking is about having the best tools, putting them in the hands of great artists. And when you see the ways in which our stories are being brought to life today, you know, visually, you see the complexity and the detail. You know, it's spectacular.
Here's to a great team.
To a great team.